Te amo, vida mía. ¿Por qué no he de decirlo si fundes tu alma con el alma mía? ¿Qué importa si después me ven llorando un día? Si acaso me preguntan, diré que te quiero mucho todavía. Se vive solamente una vez, hay que aprender a querer y a vivir. Hay que saber que la vida se aleja y nos deja llorando quimera.
Viva México. You also have Juan Davidson, John Davidson from Hollywood Squares, and that's incredible. And 55 years on television, Broadway, and film. But today I'm thinking about Mexico. Pienso en México. Me encanta México. Y lo siento, para mi español es muy limitado. Dios de los muertos. Vivimos en San Miguel de Allende por más o menos 7.5 años. Se cambió mi vida. Changed my life. I don't know. Tenemos que estudiar mucho más. Bésame, bésame mucho, como si fuera esta noche la última vez. Oh, bésame, bésame mucho, que tengo miedo perderte, perderte. Tanto tiempo disfrutamos este amor, nuestras almas se acercaron tanto así que yo guardo tu sabor, pero tú llevas también sabor a mí. Si negaras mi presencia en tu vivir, nuestras almas se acercaron tanto así. Nada vida yo te di, que por fuerza tienes ya sabor a mí. Oh, no pretendo ser tu dueño, yo soy nada, yo no tengo vanidad de mi vida. De lo bueno, soy tan pobre que otra cosa puedo dar. Pasará más de 1,000 años, muchos más. Yo no sé si tengo amor en la eternidad. Pero ya tal como aquí, en la boca llevarás sabor a mí. Somos novios. Pues los dos sentimos mucho amor profundo. Y con eso ya ganamos el más grande de este mundo. Oh, 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 oh. Nos amamos, nos besamos como novios. Nos deseamos y hasta a veces sin motivo, sin razón, nos enojamos. Somos novios, le tenemos un cariño limpio y puro. Como todos, procuramos en momentos más oscuros. para hablarnos, para darnos el más dulce de los besos. Recordar de qué color son los cerezos, sin hacer más comentarios, somos novios. Si nos dejan, it's the Romeo and Juliet story. If they'd only let us, we could live in a world of love, lleno de amor. Si nos dejan, si nos dejan, nos vamos a querer toda la vida. Si nos dejan, nos vamos a vivir en un mundo nuevo. Yo creo podemos ver un nuevo amanecer, de un nuevo día. Pienso que tú y yo podemos ser felices todavía. Si nos dejan, buscamos un rincón cerca del cielo. Si nos dejan, haremos con las nubes cielo. De ahí, juntidos los dos, cerquita del cielo, será lo que soñamos. Si nos dejan, llevo de la mano corazón, de ahí nos vamos. Si nos dejan, de todos los demás, nos olvidamos. Si nos dejan, si nos dejan. Amor de México, boleros magnífica. Solamente una vez, amé en la vida. Solamente una vez. Y nada más, una vez nada más en mi huerto brilló la esperanza. La esperanza que alumbra el camino de mi soledad. Una vez nada más, se entrega el alma con la dulce total. Renuncie eso. Cuando ese milagro me realiza el prodigio de amarse. Hay campanas de fiesta que cantan en el corazón.
Hello, everybody, and good evening. Thank you for joining us for the 2021 Secular Day of the Dead. I am here just to give you some housekeeping notes before we get started. I would like to thank our presenters and speakers and singers that just came before us. That was John Davidson singing a few songs for us. And the dancers before them were Margarita Reyna and James Nunnally. So round of applause virtually for them for all the good work that they did. And we hope that you enjoyed it as we kicked off this wonderful evening. As you can see, we have captioning going on the screen, which means that I'm going to be sharing my screen the entire time. If you would like to be able to see our speakers a little bit more, you can go to the upper right-hand corner of your screen and click on speaker view, and then there's a little bar in between the two sections, and you can slide it over and make the screen smaller and the speaker bigger if you would like to. So if you would like to be able to do that, that's an option for you. If you would like to be able to see the captioning a little bit bigger, then hopefully it is coming through for you on your end. And of course, we did invite you all to introduce yourselves in the chat and tell us where you are joining us from. We have people from all over the country this evening. And then I am going to turn it over to the founders of the Secular Day of the Dead, De la Muertos Secular, Victoria and Margaret. We have Margaret Downey and Victoria De La Torre. Turn it over to you.
Thank you. Gracias, Samantha. Hola y bienvenidos al Día de los Muertos Secular. Mi nombre es Victoria De La Torre. Yo soy co-creador de este evento hoy y también miembro de la Junta de la Free Thought Society, Sociedad de Pensamiento Libre. Tenemos aquí con nosotros la co-organizadora de hoy, mi mentor y presidente de esa sociedad, Margaret Downey.
I had to unmute, sorry about that. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. On behalf of the Free Thought Society, welcome to the 2021 Secular Day of the Dead, Día de los Muertos Secular. The Free Thought Society is a 501c3 educational organization that was founded almost 30 years ago. You can find us on the web at ftsociety.org. And we hope that you will sign up for the e-zine. Review the volunteer opportunities and visit the Free Thought Society meetup page.
Margaret fundó la sociedad en 1993 y me complació unirme a la junta directiva solo 2 años después de que empezamos a celebrar este evento con otros grupos seculares en San Diego, California. La secularización de esta hermosa celebración de la vida tiene como objetivo darle a nuestra comunidad atea una manera de continuar con los rituales culturales, pero sin religión.
Yes, and we seek to give all non-theists a day to honor deceased loved ones, recall the legacies of their dead heroes, and appreciate our one and only life. And this is why the event today will be filled with loving reflections of the life and work of many free thought secular and humanist heroes, family members, friends, and even our beloved pets.
Hoy estoy honrando a dos personas, alguien de mi familia, por supuesto, como cada año, y también una persona que quizás ustedes conozcan, la jueza de la Corte Suprema de los Estados Unidos, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Esta es mi vela para ella. Yo quiero leer algo que está escrito aquí. In memoria de Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Hay una guía en tus palabras. Con tus acciones y decisiones importantes, has dado una voz a la gente. Su legado continuará durante muchos años. Eres un ejemplo de igualdad, determinación y la justicia. Y ahora quiero encender esta vela en la memoria de ella.
That was a very nice tribute, Victoria. Justice Ginsburg is one of my heroes as well. Today, I'm proud to be honoring the life and legacy of Robert Greene Ingersoll. He is the author of hundreds of classic speeches advocating for freedom of thought and a secular democratic government. And this is my secular Saint Robert candle. Give you a little close up of that. On the back of the candle are these words. I seek to recall daily the many words of wisdom you penned for us, dear Saint Robert. I realize that my legacy is my only afterlife. As you so eloquently stated, the record of a generous life runs like a vine around the dead, and every sweet, unselfish act is now a perfumed flower. Through your advice, I will live each day in the here and the now, for now is the time to be happy, and the place to be happy is here. I'm lighting this candle in memory of the life, work, and philosophical bravery of secular Saint Robert Greene Ingersoll.
Gracias, Margaret. Qué palabras tan lindas. Hoy todos los patrocinadores de este evento tienen alguien especial que quieren reconocer.
Well, let's meet the co-sponsors and learn about who they will be honoring today.
Buenas. Antes de comenzar, quiero decir que cuando digo hispano o latino, lo uso intercambiadamente. Yo soy David Tamayo, presidente y cofundador de Hispanic American Freethinkers, libre pensadores hispanoamericanos. Una de las muchas tradiciones robadas por la religión es la celebración del Día de los Muertos. Y nosotros, como realistas que somos, estamos retornando el día para convertirlo en el día secular donde se celebra la vida, no la muerte, de nuestros seres queridos. Hoy quiero brindar honor a un hombre que tuvo mucha influencia en mi vida secular, un hombre honesto y bueno, un hombre académico que murió muy joven apenas hace 7 meses. Hablo del doctor Héctor Ábalos. Él fue profesor de religión en Iowa State University, profesor de antropología cultural y autor de muchos libros académicos. Héctor fue un hombre brillante, pero humilde, el cual salió adelante gracias a la educación. Hoy tengo muchas cosas que decir de él, pero lo que sí quiero decir es de que su vida fue muy corta. Él fundó el ISU Latino Studies Program y hoy tenemos una beca a su nombre en Jaffrey. Me queda difícil verdaderamente hablar de él y por lo tanto quiero tomar solamente esta oportunidad, aunque con mucho dolor por la pérdida de un amigo tan especial, voy a encender esta vela en su honor, sabiendo que el mundo perdió una gran persona. Y tengo dos velas, una en español y una en inglés. Pero paso, porque no puedo hablar, paso a la próxima persona. Go ahead, Samantha.
Hola, feliz Día Secular de los Muertos. Yo soy Dan Barker.
Happy Secular Day of the Dead. I'm Annie Laurie Gaylor. We're co-presidents of the Freedom From Religion Foundation, which is pleased to be a part of the 2021 Secular Day of the Dead.
The Secular Day of the Dead is a perfect way to remember the legacy of loved ones that doesn't require prayer, church, or religious dogma. At the Freedom From Religion Foundation, we're working for a religion-free government in the United States, just as we are helping sponsor this religion-free Day of the Dead. FFRF is the largest association of freethinkers, atheists, and agnostics in North America, with more than 35,000 dues-paying members.
This event and the Halloween that precedes it traditionally feature scary imagery, including imaginary phantoms. But here in the United States, we are facing some very real specters. A Supreme Court majority that looks ready to favor, privilege, and endorse Christianity at the expense of civil and personal liberties, including the right to decide if and when to become a mother. Since the last time we were together for this event, we witnessed the attempted coup on January 6th, tied to Christian nationalist, white supremacist groups and politicians. We've seen in the past year a dismaying backlash to science, including to COVID mitigation and the vaccines, these things that will rescue us from the pandemic. These threats to our lives, our health, our rights, the Constitution, show the absolute necessity of keeping religion out of government and out of our social policies.
FFRF has been working diligently since 1978 in the courts and in the court of public opinion to defend an original American principle, separating religion from government. We invite you to join us at ffrf.org in defending that ideal.
And now we'd like to honor a real American hero, Thomas Paine, a man of the Enlightenment who spoke up for the rights of men and women against slavery, who fomented the American Revolution and even gave the United States of America its very name. Thomas Paine left us a legacy of his revolutionary humanistic writings and his classic book, The Age of Reason. Paine famously said, "The world is my country, and to do good is my religion."
Thomas Paine dijo, "Mi país es el mundo, y mi religión es hacer el bien."
I'd like to light this candle to honor Thomas Paine, patron saint of independence and revolutionary action. I'm going to read the back of the candle. It declares a saint's day on his birthday, January 29th. "Saint Thomas, please bring me the strength to live my life using common sense thinking, a determination to fight against tyranny, the power to support the rights of every man and woman, and to create a new age of reason. Guide me and emulate your honest and straightforward communication skills. Create in me the power to foresee injustices that befall society and endeavor to work for the betterment of all humankind. Assist me with my work and my challenges as I study your writings. Grant me the ability to remain as steadfast and determined as you were." And now we're going to light the candle.
We're going to try to light the candle.
We're going to try.
Hold it up.
Hello, I'm Robin Blumner, and I'm the CEO of the Center for Inquiry. And it is my honor today to remember secular saint Tom Flynn. Tom Flynn, the patron saint of free thought, writing, and historical facts. Oh, secular Saint Tom, we look to your outstanding legacy to find ways to challenge those who treat non-theist citizens unfairly during religious holidays. In his honor, we will write about and take action against those who attempt to tear down the wall of separation between religion and government. Secular Saint Tom used the power of the written word to help develop a better understanding of history and freedom of thought. As we conduct our outreach and attempt to educate others, we will strive to emulate his humor, his abilities, and most of all, his determination. Ah, man and woman. Secular Saint Tom. To your memory and in your honor.
Hello, I'm Kevin Bowling, Executive Director of the Secular Student Alliance, the only national organization in the secular movement specifically working with and supporting non-religious students in middle schools, high schools, and colleges across the country. I'm honored to be representing the Secular Student Alliance here today in the Secular Day of the Dead celebration. Dia de los Muertos is a time when families and community gather and remember people who are deceased. It's an important ritual to celebrate their lives and their legacies. All societies have rituals, including the secular community. Rituals are essential for ordering our families and friendships and work and play in our personal lives. They help us form our identities, both individually and communally. Rituals are how we pass on wisdom and beliefs across generations. With the Secular Student Alliance, I work with students who are developing their identities, and we hope becoming activists throughout their lives in whatever they're passionate about, in the goal to make this world a better place before they leave. In looking for a free thought hero to honor today, who embodies education and identity and activism, I knew I wanted to share the story and accomplishments of Pauli Murray as a way to celebrate their life and intersectional legacy in US civil rights. Anna Pauline Murray was born in 1910. Pauli chose the gender non-specific name Pauli, and as an activist, they contributed some of the legal groundwork for women's rights, LGBT rights, and the civil rights movement. Pauli escaped family struggles, racial discrimination, and poverty through education. Pauli attended Hunter College for 2 years, and then attempted to enroll at Columbia University, but they were turned away because the university did not admit women. In 1939, Pauli applied to the University of South Carolina at Chapel Hill, but was refused because of their race. All schools and public facilities at that time in North Carolina were segregated. Despite obstacles to education, in 1944, Pauli graduated as valedictorian of the Harvard University law class. They graduated first in their class and was the only woman in their law school class. Pauli did postgraduate work at the University of California in Berkeley, where they wrote their master's thesis, The Right to Equal Opportunity in Employment, arguing that the right to work is an inalienable right. This thesis was published in the California Law Review. And after passing the California law exam, Pauli was hired as the state's first Black Deputy Attorney General in 1946. And was named Woman of the Year by the National Council of Negro Women. In the 1960s, prior to Reed versus Reed, Pauli began to argue that the Equal Protection Clause should be applied in cases alleging sex discrimination, like the Equal Protection Clause was applied in cases of race discrimination. In 1965, Pauli became the first African-American to receive a JSD degree from Yale Law School. Later, Pauli wrote 2 books, both of which proved profoundly influential in changing the legal foundations of sex and racial discrimination. As a board member of the American Civil Liberties Union, Pauli co-wrote the brief on White versus Crook in 1966, which struck down the all-white, all-male jury system in Alabama as unconstitutional. In 1966 as well, she became one of the co-founders of the National Organization for Women. Pauli's legal scholarship laid the groundwork for Ruth Bader Ginsburg's arguments in Reed versus Reed in 1971, marking the first time that the Equal Protection Clause would be applied to a case of sex discrimination, prohibiting differential treatment based on sex. Pauli has been identified as one of the most pivotal figures in 20th century African-American civil rights history. Thurgood Marshall and the NAACP called Pauli's 1950 book, States Law on Race and Color, the Bible for civil rights lawyers, which was especially useful in the groundbreaking 1954 Brown versus Board of Education of Topeka case. Pauli was also unambiguously and vocally queer, candid about their relationships with women, even open about being a gender non-conforming person. I want us to remember Pauli Murray and celebrate their work to address injustice and promote reconciliation between races, sexes, and economic classes throughout their work as an attorney, writer, feminist, poet, and educator. Pauli's life and career reveals bravery, persistence, and due diligence, all in the pursuit of an equal society. When I think of education, identity, and activism, I hope Pauli's story and achievements inspire the work of our students today. I hope you enjoy the event today and celebrate the people who are special in our community who work tirelessly to make this world a better place for others. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Huang, and I'm here to represent the Secular Coalition for America. We are an advocacy group that represents atheists, humanists, agnostics, and non-theists. We work with a lot of national and local secular organizations like Free Thought Society to make sure that the work we're doing is amplifying the voices of secular Americans. But I'm here tonight not only to talk about SCA, but also to honor the memories of my two amazing role models in my life. That is my grandfather, Huang Dinyuan, and my grandmother, Huang Titlan. It's a picture of them back in the 90s. Yeah, this is the traditional Vietnamese dress that Vietnamese women wear. So my grandfather was the director of the National Institute of Science and Technology in Vietnam. He was a biologist, a professor. He was also a polyglot who loves studying languages. He speaks 7 or 8 languages, and also a ladybug lover. The amount of ladybugs, beetle samples in our house when I was growing up is incredible. My grandmother was a teacher, was also a biologist. She was an educator of many generations of students at Hanoi Amsterdam High School, and she was definitely a rock to our family during the war and even after that, as well as to her many students, I'm sure. And they inspire me to follow my dreams and fight for what I believe in. So this is a little poem for them. They say a grandparent is someone you can always call, will pick you up if you should fall. Always giving a loving hug, the ones that feel so warm and snug. A hug is impossible now, but your legacy will remain clear and loud. Scientists by profession and educators at heart, you were gentle and kind even when the times got hard. Bounded by no god, you were free to explore, sailing the world, and all you wanted to do was just to see more. Collecting samples and keeping them intact, you were the one that brought light to the facts. Hey, little ladybirds, you carry my last name. Please remember that word for the meanings it will always contain. to the generations of visioners and builders you taught, to the word that couldn't make you stop, to the sacrifice that you made, to the passion that you gave. I know that there are some mayors out there and a few Buddhist monks who care. Many scientists will benefit from the contents that you published. I will carry on your visions and all of your story, no matter the past, present, or future of the journey. Thank you for everything, and I love you so. I take your knowledge, let's make a show. Your love for the world will shine forevermore, and for that, we salute you so much more to explore. Now I'm gonna light a candle to honor them. So thank you everyone for attending and for allowing me to have the space to honor them and their memories. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret, and thank you everyone for this lovely event. My name is Nick Fish. I'm the president of American Atheists, and it's a pleasure to be here. American Atheists was founded, as many of you know, in 1963 by Madeline Murray O'Hare, a woman who was one of a kind. She was an outspoken atheist, an outspoken woman, at a time when being either of those two things was no easy task. She was a fighter for what she believed in, and her work laid the foundation for so much of what we've accomplished since then, starting with her landmark Supreme Court case, fighting to end forced indoctrination of young people in our nation's public schools. In that Supreme Court case, Madeline was crystal clear about what she believed. She believed that a hospital should be built instead of a church, that a deed should be done instead of a prayer said, and that we must strive for involvement in this life rather than escape into death. Those values and those commitments still resonate with all of us today. That's why American Atheists now has more than 250 local groups all throughout the country. These groups fight every single day to make their communities a better place. Their leaders and their members dedicate countless hours building the kinds of communities that have helped all of us get through this past year and a half. American Atheists continues to advocate on behalf of the millions of American atheists who want laws and policies that reflect our values. And we work to create a more just, more equitable, more reasonable world. We're a voice for the countless atheists who face discrimination and stigma simply because of who we are. We stand on the shoulders of many strong women, just like Madeline Murray O'Hare, and many others that we unfortunately don't have time to recognize today. We've all lost loved ones this past year, many of them gone far too soon. And in recognition of that loss, I'm lighting this candle today, celebrating the trailblazing life of Madeline Murray O'Hare. Thank you for having me here today.
Bienvenidos. I'm Arlene Rios, Vice President of Atheists United. I would like to start with Una Calaverita or Una Calavera, which is a poem recited for the Day of the Dead. This calaverita was written by Gloria Parafox. The poem is in Spanish. Al saber del virus, la calaca tilaca y flaca, de gusto se puso a bailar y tocar la maraca. Pues muchas almas se llevaría desde China hasta Cuernavaca. Se dijo a sí misma, me iré hasta el mar con Alfonsina, pero yo en una barca, pues quiero llegar a tiempo hasta donde la epidemia abarca. Más al ver la soledad de los lugares y ver que se asemejaban a Comala, sintió tristeza y ya no quiso ser mala, deseando que la pandemia pronto acabara.
Hi, my name is Luis Campos. I'm a member of Atheists United and Arlene Rios' husband. I just wanted to acknowledge that Día de los Muertos comes from a Native American tradition, the tradition of the Mexica people of what is now known as Mexico. It honors, it's the feast day of Mictlantecuhtli, who was the god of the underworld. She was charged with consuming the cosmos every morning so that the sun could rise. And with that, I just wanted to take that on there, and I'd invite you all to learn something about the Mexica people. They're still alive to this day, and most Mexicans claim to be descendants of them. Thank you. Arlene?
Atheists United is a nonprofit organization for folks who identify as atheists, agnostics, secularists, skeptics, freethinkers, or humanists. Our mission is to build thriving atheist communities, empower people to express their secular values, and promote separation of government and religion. Today, Atheist United honors and celebrates the life of Bobby Kirkhart. Bobby was the matriarch of Atheist United. She was a former president of Atheist United and was a fixture of the atheist movement for nearly four decades. I first met Bobby at Heretic House, her century-old Victorian home, to pitch my idea of forming a secular space for the Latinx community of the San Gabriel Valley. This is a picture of Bobby with our current president, Christina Jones. Bobby was a generous person. She opened her home to the atheist community, hosting visitors from around the world. We celebrated birthday parties, volunteer events, meet and greets, speaker events, and choir rehearsals. Bobby's home was our headquarters to organize the Los Angeles secular atheist community. Bobby had an inquisitive mind. She participated in the But I Progress book club. In this club, we engaged in frank discussions about a variety of topics. She was always ready to engage and participate as a listener and contribute to her thoughts and wisdom. Bobby encouraged me and others, inviting us to share with her news about the work we were doing in the secular community. I am grateful for her leadership and friendship. Tenía un corazón de oro y la vamos a extrañar muchísimo. Thank you.
Bueno, gracias a todos ustedes que hablaron. Ahora, con mucho gusto, vamos a presentar un video. Actor, comediante y actor Julia Sweeney y actor John Huertas. Julia Sweeney entrevistará a John Huertas sobre su viaje personal, desde afligido y santo a ateo feliz. Espero que lo disfruten.
Hello, everyone. I'm Julia Sweeney, and I'm here introducing John Huertas, who you may know, he's an actor. I'm a big fan, and he's on This Is Us, and he was on Generation Kill and Castle. And I think you did an episode of Beverly Hills 90210, if I'm not mistaken.
I did.
My era of TV watching. And he is currently on This Is Us, but also directing and doing all kinds of wonderful stuff. So I'm very excited to interview him. And I'm very happy to know that he's part of this non-believing community, which we both hope gains in strength and numbers. And John is a lifelong non-believer with a couple of flies in the ointment, which I love that phrase that you put down. We'll get into that in a minute. But anyway, so John, I'm just assuming based on your Hispanic last name, Huertas, that you were raised Catholic, but is that true?
Yes, I'm a recovering Catholic. I was actually born into Catholicism like any good assimilated Black Tino, you know, one of the millions of surviving descendants of the indigenous people / victims of the most devastating genocide and land grab in history, all in the name of Jesus. I'm also a descendant of the indigenous people who were kidnapped from their continent, the continent of Africa, whose names, culture, religion, families, all were violently erased as they were forced into slavery, all in the name of spreading the word of God.
Well, congratulations on surviving that history.
Yeah.
So what happened? Like, what was the beginning? Were you, tell me about yourself as a young believer.
Well, I was an altar boy in Catholic school. And around third grade, you know, they really dive into the Bible, especially in the Old Testament when you're a kid in Catholic school. I think it's actually the best time to instill the fear of God in a person. And being told to fear the most loving being in the universe, I thought to myself, why doesn't that make sense to me? Fear God, because if you don't, he might flood the shit out of you or make you sacrifice your own family. But remember, God loves you. You know, I was like, what the fuck? And then I spent 4 more years of Catholic school. And then right when I got to confirmation, that's when I said, no, thanks. I don't believe any of this bullshit, including Santa Claus. That was done.
And that's when you just felt like it wasn't lining up for you. The logic of it, just you couldn't take it.
No, I couldn't take it. And then a bunch of the other kids, they ended up calling me an atheist. And it was actually the first time I had ever heard that word. And I think what we were taught, yeah, in Catholic school was that if you're an atheist, you're a devil worshiper. And I was like, no, I don't believe in that guy either. And all I remember were a bunch of these kids' faces just staring back at me, confused, mortified, not knowing what to make of this crazy kid.
Wow. And so tell me about how you actually did become an atheist. How did you really...
Well, that goes to a couple of these flies in the ointment moments that I mentioned earlier.
Okay.
So after confirmation, I was pretty much a non-believer. But then at the end of high school, I was a 17-year-old working at Sears. And I was approached by this really, really cute new sales associate. And of course, heavy flirting ensued. And I found out that she had just started and was looking to kind of connect with someone who worked the same shift as she did. And the first thing she asked me was, are you Christian? And of course, with the prospect of getting a date, I said, hell yeah, I'm a Catholic. And then she looked at me right in the eyes and said, you're not a Christian. You're not saved. And I was like, yeah. What the fuck is she talking about? And long story short, she ended up being this 22-year-old married woman whose husband ran a church basketball team that had no people of color on it. So they lost all the time and were hoping if they could recruit me, which they did, that they might start winning some games. And then soon after that, I literally spent an entire day of my life getting saved, which in reality was me just conducting my own experiment on the power of suggestion. Of course, I thought I was saved. I mean, I was a really, really convincing 17-year-old. I believed everything that I conceived of.
You're a good actor.
Exactly. Especially, I really convinced myself that little baby Jesus himself had entered into my heart and cleansed me of my sin. And then one Friday, I remember being invited over to their house for dinner, as I had done many times before, only this time I found out that her husband wasn't there. He was out of town for some, you know, religious retreat or something like that. And that she had a different plan for dessert that night, me. And I was just absolutely crushed, devastated. I felt so betrayed and I stormed out of there feeling fucking stupid.
I need a play by play. Like, what happened? Like, she just leaned over to kiss you or she groped you? Like, what?
We had dinner. We went into their living room. I thought we were going to talk about, you know, me being saved. I was really excited. I was really happy. And
did they have children?
They didn't have any children.
Okay.
And she started, you know, like climbing on me, trying to kiss me.
Let me give you a massage.
It's always that's the gateway.
The gateway. Okay. Massage. Yeah.
So she's, you know, she basically, you know, tried to jump on me. I'm a 17-year-old kid. She's a 23-year-old woman.
And I'm amazed you resisted.
I did because I was taking this Christian thing serious. I really believed that, you know, Jesus was in my heart watching everything I was doing. And I'm not supposed to be, you know, getting down with some married woman.
Wow. Okay. So then when you left, so what were you thinking about religion? I mean, it seems to me like you might just think they were terrible people, but you were still a good Christian.
I think, you know, It took me back to just, you know, there was always a contradiction in religion. Everything that I think I was pretty, you know, I had a a very grounded way of looking at things, very logical way of looking at things. And, I was operating from a place of reason from a young age. So, you know, everything they had kind of told me and that I was learning through them and their Bible study in their church, like there was always a contradiction. So, you know, I just kind of flipped the coin. I always had the coin. The coin was either on heads or tails. And so I was back to tails.
How old were you?
That's when I was 17. And then the second time that I was a seeker was many years later. After this, I had an 8-year stint in the Air Force, about 5 years working as an actor and about 2 years of not working as an actor. And I was at that point in my life where I was just having the longest string of bad luck ever, barely working, crashed my girlfriend's car. My dog was run over by a monster truck on my birthday at the first birthday party that I'd ever had in my life. And then I went through the worst breakup I'd ever had. And I thought, oh, shit.
Was it her dog?
No, it was my dog. Okay. And I was like, oh, shit, maybe it's because I don't have Jesus in my life.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. So even then, you were still thinking that could be it. Okay, so then what happened?
Well, that's how they get you, right? You know, if you don't, all these things that are happening to you, someone will put a little plantable seed in your ear saying that, you know, maybe it's because you don't pray or you don't go to church. And so I had this friend of mine, and he didn't really do this to me. He's actually, in my opinion, he's a good Christian because he doesn't try to convert people or sell me on it. But he was a really good friend of mine, and he was pumped that I went to him instead of him having to come to me, saying that I wanted to see if, because I don't have Jesus in my life, that I might be able to turn around everything that's going on. So he took me to this Presbyterian church every Sunday for about 3 months, where I heard the pastor tell his congregants that everyone was welcome. We welcome everyone and love everyone into our community, and to include the gay contingency of people who showed up every week. And
that's good.
Yeah, it was really good. And one Sunday in one of his sermons, he was preaching that homosexuality was an abomination in God's eyes.
Now even that there was the gay community there.
The gay community was right there, and they all sat in the same place all the time. And it ended up being the most uncomfortable Sunday of my life. All eyes, as soon as he said all this, all eyes in the entire church, their heads turned, and they were on this contingency of gay folks to see how they were reacting. And of course, all of the gay congregants were squirming in their chairs, very uncomfortable at what Pastor Mark was saying on stage. And I was just disgusted. And then on another Sunday, he went on this rant, this ranting sermon about how premarital sex was also a huge no-no and some kind of problematic sin. And this moment right here, that's when I knew they were really starting to lose me. The final straw.
When your line in the sand is premarital sex.
Oh, yeah, premarital. And then the final straw was a girl that I had met there and had started dating who subscribed to the whole premarital sex sin theory. She ambushed me.
And what do you mean by ambush? Tell me what happened.
So her being anti-sex meant that we weren't compatible as a couple. And I talked to her about that. I was like, you know, hey, yeah, I get it. You don't want to have sex. That's what I do on a normal basis. So we should just be friends, right?
But I do is sex. No,
that's what I do. It's my job. But then after one of Pastor Mark's sermons, she told me that there was this part of the church that I hadn't seen yet that was really cool. And so she ushered me down these steps through a hallway and into this room where two people I had never met before were sitting and waiting to pray over our relationship, that they were going to enlist God's help to get us in alignment. Because they knew that it was in God's plan for us to work out and work through this turbulent time we were having. Now, first of all, I was like, the fuck are you talking about? There's nothing turbulent about this. I'm a shagger. She's not. It's not going to work. End of story. And second, when I heard this God's plan thing, I think that was, in my life, one of the most profound moments for me. How these people sincerely and unquestionably believe that there's some invisible sentient being that pulls all of our strings and dictates our existence. And I was done. I mean, to be honest, every time I heard Pastor Mark up there reading from the Bible anyway, I was like, how is any of this, any of what I'm hearing, any different from Harry Potter or any of the other sci-fi fantasy novels that I had ever read in my life at that point?
Right. So it wasn't just sex. It was like all the stories. Just
it was all these stories.
Resonate with you.
Absolutely. And it was me having this moment of clarity. And I think from that day on, which was
nearly okay, but wait, I need more play by play. Like when she brings you down to this basement, there's these two people there. They're going to pray over you to say, have the strength to not have sex till you get married. Or do you think they want you to just propose to her or something? Like,
no, they actually, I mean, they sat me down because I ended up participating because, you know, I felt ambushed. I was vulnerable in my mind and my heart. So I sat down, held hands with these people that I'd never met before. And they just started praying. And it was literally, I mean, they've got their eyes closed and they're looking, and I'm eyes wide open, just watching all of this go down. And I'm like, this is the last straw. I'm done. And by the way, this girl who didn't want to have premarital sex, we would mess around. We'd make out. And there was one moment, and she loved, you know, she loved to have an orgasm in whatever way, which was, you know, clothes on clothes, you know, shifting and grinding and all that stuff. And there was, you know, soon clothes would come off, soon like things would happen. And then there was one moment when, I'm sorry, but we had sex. It didn't go like, it didn't go as far as I like it to go, but it went far enough where she got, you know, she got
what you had sexual relations with that woman.
And so I had sexual relations with that woman, and she denied it. I said afterwards, I was like, well, we had sex. She was like, no, we didn't.
Oh, wow.
I've done this quite a few times. I know what it feels like. We had sex. Like, I know where all my body parts were.
Wow. What amount of denial is she in to just refuse to even accept that that was true? Wow. Yeah.
And so that's the thing. Like, her mind, she's so brainwashed that she did by all of this that she didn't see the reality in life. She didn't see the reality in the moments that we shared. And that's what I feel like happens with people who subscribe to this dogma, is that they live in a different reality from what reality actually is. So that from that day forward, after I was ambushed 20 years.
So you leave, and does she know you guys are broken up when you've left the room?
I don't think that she did. No.
She didn't. So
no,
because she's in denial. We've established that. Okay.
Yeah.
So you break up with her right after that. Is that what happens?
Not right. I mean, it wasn't the same day. We leave. I get in my car. I go to my house, and I contemplate, how am I going to tell this girl that, first of all, I'm never going back to this church, because that church was very important to her, and that her and I will never see just her again. Like, how do I tell her? Because I'm not just going to ghost. I don't do that. So I...
Oh, painful.
I know. I asked her to meet me for a coffee. Mm-hmm. We met for a coffee, and I explained to her that I'm no longer a seeker. And she started to get a little excited because she thought I was going to say that I'm now Christian. And I said, I'm no longer a seeker. I am definitely an atheist, which means that you and I aren't compatible in two ways. I like to have sexual intercourse, and I don't believe in this craziness called God.
Oh my God.
Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And she was mortified, and
This is here in Los Angeles.
Absolutely. Okay. This was happening in San Fernando Valley in a coffee shop. And she was mortified, and then that became anger. She got so angry, and we had never really had this like full on commitment of, you know, we're boyfriend, girlfriend, we're moving forward, we're creating a life together.
Right.
To me, it was always just kind of dating. You know, it wasn't that, you know, to me, it was, hey, this isn't working out. Let's move on before it gets too serious. She got so angry because she was so hurt and saw that, you know, I think part of it was saw that she was, you know, her and I were going to go on, but also saw that, you know, we're losing another Christian.
Ah! Oh, my God. Okay, so you get out of it. And then when do you just, is that really it? That was it.
That was 20 years ago, about 20 years ago now.
Wow.
20 years ago. And from that point on, I was like, I just regard God, Santa Claus, fairies, elves, gnomes, they're all part of the same tribe living in a land called imagination.
Yeah.
And that's what my heart tells me on a daily basis. And logically, that the problems in our society don't stem from a battle between good and evil. They stem from humans having a lack of responsibility for their own actions. And well, not me and you. I mean, you and I.
Well, and each other too, but in a serious way, without just invoking superstitions. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, a common theme for people who are religious, and not just Christianity, Catholicism, all, in my opinion, organized religions, you know, a common theme is that anything good that happens to us should be, you know, we should thank God, thank our creator, thank that, you know, that super being that's created all of us. Or anything bad that happens is part of this being's plan.
I know.
And no, I'm like, no, if something bad happens, it was just an accident, or someone else, a human, fucked up. And
yeah. Or it was good for someone else, but bad for you. I mean, like,
exactly.
There's all kinds of ways it can be. Yeah.
Exactly. And if something great happens to us, someone did that for us. It was done, you know, we did it for ourselves. But it's human intervention.
Yeah.
Right. It was human intervention. Or even something good that happens could also just be a happy accident.
Yeah.
So for that reason, I'm a non-theist.
And let me ask you this. Over the last 20 years, do you feel like your life is better for not having religion in it?
It is absolutely better. I have, you know, I just said this to someone last night. In fact, someone who's been a devout Catholic. He's about 70 years old. He is my wife's dad's best friend. And her dad has died. And so this is kind of, he's almost like her father now, in a way. And I said to him, you know, I've had good fortune in my life since then, literally since I decided to just never be a seeker again. I got one of my favorite jobs of all time on a series right after that. And that was always my goal, was to have a career at, you know, entertaining people and entertaining myself while I'm doing it. And, you know, to find a great partner in life, which is my wife, which I met right after that, to do something great for my family, bought my mom a house, all of these things. None of it happened by me kneeling beside my bed, making the sign of the cross and praying to someone out there. None of that happened. It all happened because I applied myself. I received gifts that other people gave me, whether it be advice, whether it be a handout, a hand reaching back and pulling me up, whatever it was. It was divine human intervention, not some other divinity.
Well, I mean, of course, it could have gone badly too, and that could happen if there's no God. But I would say for me that when you stop believing, there's this huge brain space that opens up for very practical thinking through how to solve the problems of your life. So I would say my success, the good things that have happened to me, benefited greatly from not believing, because I could think about it practically and realistically, right, and not superstitiously. So.
And you can now redirect any energy that you're going to put into this belief.
Right.
All that energy could be diverted and put into growth, personal growth. And that's what I think is has been paramount for me. I didn't spend, you know, I didn't spend Sundays going to a church. I didn't spend any time in my mind wondering if what I'm doing in life is appeasing some, you know, being, some sentient being, some God, some creator. I don't spend time worrying about that. I spend time thinking that if there is a heaven, I'm living it now.
Mm-hmm. Aww.
My heaven is being able to be on this interview with you.
Oh, wow. That's very flattering, John.
You are my Lord and Savior.
Oh, God. Wow. Well, I love your story, and I'm sure everyone's going to enjoy hearing it. I certainly did. And I'm so thankful that you did this and for such a great cause. And yay, onward.
Yes. Thank you for doing this with me. This was a lot of fun.
Oh, good.
And I hope everybody enjoys, Dia de los Muertos celebration.
Which is, by the way, such a great idea to have a day where you're thinking of the dead. I mean, the truth is there's a lot of rituals that come from religion that are very practical and meaningful for everyone and don't have to be connected to superstitions.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's why I love that this holiday, Halloween has always been my favorite holiday. Dios de Muertos has always been a part of my life because of my heritage. And I think like to do a secular version of it is just, you know, it makes us have the ability to create fun for everyone in this moment. And it's a celebration of, you know, a big part of life, which is death. And right. We should, you know, and I've always been a firm believer that, you know, death is part of life. And to celebrate the end of someone's life is better to me than to mourn the end of someone's life.
That was a fascinating story. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. A little bit of it was R-rated, but we are at a nighttime event. So, and we want to apologize for not having our English to Spanish closed captioning for you. Something went wrong. And we're trying to fix it and work on that right now. But we thank both John and Julia for contributing to today's program. You can learn more about John Huertas and Julia Sweeney through their Wikipedia pages. And I'm going to start the honoring ceremony portion of the program by lighting a candle to honor the life of my mother, Ana Justa Alacia. My mother died of COVID in January of this year. She was 94 years old. This is the candle I created for her. Don't know if you can see that. And I'm going to read the back of the candle. My dear mother had a difficult life. I appreciate her commitment to doing her best to rear three children in spite of suffering from mental illness. I seek to emulate my mother's resolve to work hard and provide to others the things that make life comfortable. I also will light this candle on behalf of my mother's half-brothers and half-sisters. They thank her for bringing them to the United States of America, giving them a place to live, finding them employment, and providing many opportunities to discover love in order to create a home for themselves. I had to learn how to overcome a difficult childhood. And I did so by reading as much as I could about personality disorders. And thanks to the scientific approach and research that I did, I was able to accept and understand the negative circumstances our family had to deal with. Seeking valuable information enabled me to not only accept and understand, but also to forgive. For those of you who can relate, I recommend the exercise of obtaining knowledge to help heal difficult relationships.
Gracias, Margaret. Continuando con la ceremonia de homenaje, tenemos aquí con nosotros tres personas que quieren honrar a alguien especial que ha cambiado el mundo. Escucharemos al actor y autor Fernando Alcántar, al líder de cultura ética Hugh Taft Morales y la educadora Consuelo Cortés de Fleming.
Hello everyone, my name is Fernando Alcántar and I am the author of To the Cross and Back. For this year's Day of the Dead, I want to honor someone who is very special to me and to a lot of people around this country and around the world. His name is Matthew Shepard. Matthew Wayne Shepard was born on December 1st of 1976, just about 6 months before I was. And on the night of October 6th of 1998, Matthew was brutally beaten, tortured, and left to die near Laramie, Wyoming. Two other guys of the same age as Matthew, Aaron McKinney and Russell Henderson, approached Matthew at the Fireside Lounge there in Laramie. They then took him out to a remote rural area, robbed him, slammed a pistol against his head over and over, tied him to a barbed wire fence, and drove off, leaving him there to suffer under near freezing temperatures. Matthew spent 18 hours hanging on that fence, in a coma, until he was found by a cyclist who had confused him with a scarecrow. His face was completely covered in blood, except for the trail that a tear had cleansed on his face. Matthew hung on to life for 5 more days and was pronounced dead just past midnight on October 12th. According to the original story, Aaron and Russell attacked Matthew in retaliation for a sexual advance that Matthew had done because Matthew was gay. The story made world headlines, with candlelight vigils popping all over the globe. At his funeral, members of the Westboro Baptist Church staged a demonstration with signs which included messages like "Matt in hell" and "God hates fags." His father had to wear a bulletproof vest. Fast forward to 2009, the Matthew Shepard and James Byrd Jr. Hate Crimes Prevention Act was signed into law by President Barack Obama. The bill adds as hate crimes those that include crimes motivated by a victim's actual or perceived gender, sexual orientation, gender identity, or disability. On September of 2013, the Book of Matt was published. In it, a different story was uncovered stating that Matthew was not murdered because of his sexual orientation, but in fact, that it was a drug deal gone wrong. Many activists have argued that this version takes away from the homophobic attacks that Matthew and many of us in the LGBT community suffer on a daily basis, but many others, including myself, argue that it actually feels like a more accurate perspective of what LGBTQ people suffer, especially in rural America. Matthew Shepard was a scrawny, unathletic, 5'2" little kid who was afraid of people finding out who he was. He hopped from school to school trying to find himself, and he had to drive for hours in the middle of the night to try to find a gay club, the only safe haven that many of us could find back in those days. Matthew's name is now on a bill that protects me and many others in the LGBT community against hate crimes. Yet Matthew never knew about this bill. He never knew about the vigils. He never knew he would be a martyr, a legend. He was a beautiful young man, human being that I wish I had known as a friend. Matthew, I honor your memory. And may we never forget what is taken for those of us who come after you to be free. Thank you, Matthew.
Hi, I'm Hugh Taft Morales. So why are we gathered on this Zoom platform? Well, many cultures throughout history have honored those dead and gone because they believed it would help the soul of the deceased find eternal rest. Without proper memorial rites, so the legends go, the souls of the deceased remain in our world as ghosts, haunting reminders that we have not given them a proper send-off. Today, I want to honor those many who have died during the pandemic without appropriate rites, with no in-person memorials after their death because of the limits on in-person gatherings. And we miss these gatherings, gatherings so full of tears and laughter, sadness and joy, memories and love. So I light this candle in memory of the many dead as a symbolic hug to the families and friends that were denied an in-person memorial to offer each other comfort and to honor the person they lost. I'll light one other candle for another person who was denied an in-person memorial, the man who led the Philadelphia Ethical Society before me, Richard Kinnaird. Richard died on December 18, 2019. Along with his family, I was planning a memorial for April 2020 when COVID arrived. We hit the pause button and we've been paused ever since. We've been unable to meet together in person to honor him. So Richard's been haunting me a bit, not in any supernatural way, of course, because the only ghosts that exist are those in our heads and in our hearts. Of course, Richard, a self-described curmudgeon during the time I knew him, would agree in principle that an in-person memorial would be nice and appropriate rites would be a good thing. But he'd probably say that I was being a little bit melodramatic this evening. Screw the ceremony, he would say. Just get back to work. Because what matters are our memories of those who have left us and how they inspire us to carry forward in the work that we shared with them while they were alive. So in that spirit, I'm making a donation today in Richard's name to one of his favorite areas of work during his time at the Ethical Society, supporting the children of Camp Linden, a program that we run each summer. While I still hope that there will be time to honor Richard in person, where we can gather to support each other and give him a proper send-off, tonight I just offer a bit of comfort to the ghost in my head and in my heart by supporting the work he poured himself into. May all those who knew Richard continue to heal the wound of his loss by feeling deep gratitude for his life. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Consuelo Cortez de Fleming. Today, I would like to honor Gabriel Garcia Marquez. He was from Colombia and he was born in March of 1927 and he died April 2014. Gabriel Garcia Marquez was one of the greatest writers of the 20th century and winner of the 1982 Nobel Prize for Literature. He's considered the master of magical realism and creator of great love stories that will forever stay with you. His way of writing and his imagination will make you see reality in a new way, a magical one. His descriptions will reach every single one of your senses and shake you to your very core. You'll see colors, smell the roses, feel the rhythms, and finally get a taste of magic. You'll be taken on a breathtaking journey where everything is surreal and love is endless and his is exactly why we love Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Those who had a chance to read his masterpiece, 100 Years of Solitude or 100 Años de Soledad, can probably relate to all this. And for those who didn't read it, here are 13 of Gabriel Garcia Marquez quotes that will make you change your mind. It's like almost everything that come out of this Colombian's mouth or pen. These lines represent the entire learning of life and hope, beautiful lines that I am sure will reach your heart. If you know them, it will be very good to reread them. An extra dose of joy and love never hurts. If this is the first time you hear, write them down in a notebook and always keep them with you. You never know when you will need them. Here we go. First line, I love you not for who you are, but for who I am when I'm with you. Number two, no person deserves your tears, and whoever deserves them will never make you cry. Number three, just because someone doesn't love you the way you want, doesn't mean they don't love you in their own way. Number four, a true friend is the one who takes your hand and touches your heart. Number five, the worst way to miss someone is to be sitting next to them and knowing that you can never have them. Six, never stop smiling, not even when you're sad. because you never know who can fall in love with your smile. Number 7, you can be only one person in the world, but for one person, you are the world. Number 8, do not spend time with someone who is not willing to spend it with you. Number 9, maybe you need to meet a lot of wrong people before you meet the right person, so that when you finally meet them, you will know how to be grateful. Number 10, do not cry because it's over. Smile because it happened. 11, there will always be people who hurt you. So, what you have to do is keep trusting and just be more careful who you trust twice. Number 12, become a better person and make sure you know who you are before meeting someone else and expecting that person to know who you are. Number 13, don't try so hard. The best things happen when you least expect them. Today, I would like to light a candle to honor Gabriel Garcia Marquez.
Thanks to Fernando, Hugh, and Consuelo. Before we move to the next segment of the program, we're going to take a short break. After this short break, Victoria and I will be joined in the hosting duties by David Tamayo from Hispanic American Freethinkers.
Mientras tanto, disfrutan esta música de Christine Magallanes.
A very special event to honor and celebrate our dead loved ones. The Day of the Dead celebration originates from the ancient traditions of Mesoamerica's pre-Columbian cultures about 3,000 years ago. Those traditions endured in Aztec culture from the 14th century until the 16th century as a month-long celebration. However, Spanish colonialism and its Christian influence have transformed the lengthy celebration into a shorter 3-day event that coincides with the Catholic Church's All Saints Day on November 1st. Currently, the Day of the Dead continues its metamorphosis as it has become popular around the world and most recently depicted in the film Coco. Today, we celebrate it as our own uniquely secular rendition.
Bienvenidos a este evento tan especial para honrar y celebrar a nuestros amados muertos. La celebración del Día de Muertos tiene su origen en las antiguas tradiciones de las culturas precolombinas de Mesoamérica hace unos 3,000 años. Esas tradiciones perduraron en la cultura azteca por siglos XIV hasta el siglo XVI como una celebración de un mes de duración. Sin embargo, el colonialismo español y su influencia cristiana han transformado la larga celebración por un evento más corto de 3 días, que coincide con el Día de Todos los Santos de la Iglesia Católica el 1 de noviembre. Actualmente, el Día de Muertos continúa su metamorfosis al haberse popularizado en todo el mundo y más recientemente representado en la película Coco. Hoy lo celebramos como nuestra propia interpretación secular única.
So this is a song that dates back to the early 20th century and became popular around 1940 and has been recorded throughout the years by many, many Latin American artists up until this day. The name of the song is called La Llorona. Thank you. No sé qué tienen las flores, llorona, las flores del campo santo. No sé qué tienen las flores, llorona, las flores del campo santo. Que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona, parece que están llorando. Que cuando las mueve el viento, llorona, parece que están llorando. Ay, de mi llorona, llorona, tú eres mi shulka. Ay, de mi llorona, llorona, tú eres mi shulka. Me quitarán de quererte, llorona, pero de olvidarte nunca. Me quitarán de quererte, llorona, pero de olvidarte nunca.
Hola a todos. Durante esta parte de la ceremonia de homenaje, primero escucharemos a personas que hicieron una reserva para honrar a sus seres queridos fallecidos. Yo voy a empezar la ceremonia con unas palabras de mi abuelito, Carlos Antonio de la Torre Ruiz. Aquí está conmigo y mis primas. Bueno, mi abuelito siempre tenía alegría en su cara y también en su corazón. Me enseñó a sonreír durante los momentos difíciles, apreciar cada día y encontrar significado en las cosas pequeñas de la vida. Continuando su legado con el nombre de mi hijo, que yo puse el nombre Antonio, como su bisabuelo, Carlos Antonio de la Torre. Entonces yo voy a prender esa vela para él, en nombre de él. Gracias.
Qué lindo. Gracias, Victoria, por compartir con nosotros sobre tu abuelo. Yo sé que significaba mucho para ti. Entonces, continuamos a ver si escuchamos de Rick Rohrer. Honrará a su querido amigo, Jim Barry.
Great. I appreciate this opportunity today, Don, and my good friend Jim Berry. And I'll tell you, let me put it, can I share my screen also? I'll get my, okay, never mind. I'll just hold up the picture when the time comes instead of sharing my screen, because that'll work out just handy too. Anyway, Jim and I both grew up in Chicago, and I met him in the mid 80s at an FFRF convention. And because of that connection, we sort of hit it off. He was living in Minneapolis at the time. So some years later, when I moved to Minneapolis for work, he was about the only person I knew there. And Jim was kind enough to greet me at the airport and show me around town and make me feel at home there. We discovered during that trip that both he and I enjoy ribs and beer. So we used to get together at a rib joint and get some ribs and beer. And Jim, in his typical humor, called it the Dead Pig Society, because the Dead Poet Society was a big movie back then. You can just imagine that. And there's a funny story about that that I probably don't have time to tell today, so I won't. Anyway, I got this picture of Jim. I hope you can see it. It's him speaking at the Day of Reason at the Minnesota Capitol, where we got the Minnesota Atheists got a group inside the Capitol while folks are out there. Outside doing the Day of Prayer, the Minnesota Atheists were inside doing the Day of Reason, kind of as an answer to it. But I'll tell you one thing, besides his warm welcome and his friendship, Jim gave me something that was maybe even more lasting and more important. I have here a book that Jim found for me, Robert Ingersoll. I had never heard of Robert Ingersoll until I met Jim. I was happy to see that we paid him a proper tribute directly to Robert Ingersoll earlier today. And this was a time before the internet when it was really hard to find out-of-print books, and Jim scoured used bookstores to find this for me because he knew what a good book it was. You know, before I read Robert Ingersoll, I kind of felt like I was an atheist, but I was almost ashamed of it. I didn't believe that I had a basis for morality in my life. And Robert Ingersoll did a beautiful job at disabusing me of that notion. Now I'm proud because of that. And Jim was an avid collector of books, and he had a full collection of Robert Ingersoll that he was very proud of. And he's a supporter of the Robert Ingersoll Birthplace Museum. Jim died earlier this year from cancer, and I'm sorry to see him go. I'll miss my friend. But I've got that book on my shelf. I still treasure it. And I still treasure his memory. And I want to just finish here with a light a candle for Jim here and probably repeat one of his most favorite quotes from Robert Ingersoll. Happiness is the only good. The time to be happy is now. The place to be happy is here. The way to be happy is to make others so. Truer words were never spoken. Thank you, Jim.
And thank you, Rick. Jim Berry was a dear friend of mine as well, and I miss him so much. There was one time when I flew in to give a speech to Chicago area, and Jim, unbeknownst to me, had arranged for me to fly first class. And he met me at the terminal, and was such a wonderful gentleman. So I have very special memories of Jim as well. You did a wonderful job, Rick. Thank you. The next reserved honoring ceremony slot is for Christine Magalinas Jones. You saw her perform earlier for the break, and now we get her live.
Okay, got it. I wasn't allowed to unmute for a few seconds there. I'm honoring somebody that has already been mentioned today, and that's our good friend, my good friend, and Atheist United's very good friend, and many other secular organizations' good friend, Bobby Kirkhart. And I'll put a picture of her here. I don't know if we can. Well, maybe it's not going to work very well, but that's okay. Was such a pillar in our community. This is very fresh for all of us here in Los Angeles. She died this past weekend. So right now we're kind of scrambling and collecting ourselves to process her death, which was unexpected. So, but she is my friend and colleague, and she was a tour de force in the Los Angeles secular community and beyond. Through her many decades of activism, she became an icon in the free thought community, and her beautiful Victorian home in Los Angeles became the hub of many community events. as well as a place to host secular leaders from around the country and around the world. It was and is a very special place, and many people here have been there. She was a genuine, kind, and generous friend and mentor to me as well. A very good friend, very good mentor, and to whom I'm greatly indebted. And I'm going to light this candle. I don't know if you can see, yeah, you can see this. I'm doing it an old-fashioned way. I'm actually striking a match. So. Okay, and to Bobby Kirkhart, I light this candle. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. Beautiful, wonderful tribute. The next speaker will be Johnny Jones Cortez, my brother. Thank you for sharing.
Hey, everybody, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Cool. All right, awesome. Thanks everybody for allowing me to talk today. And thanks to my sister for allowing me to talk about one of my favorite people of all time. And that's Christopher Hitchens. And I know Margaret had a great relationship with Christopher, and I'm so jealous of that. And I always try to pick apart her brain and just see, you know, just some insight in how he was as a person. And it's always a good story. So with that said, if you don't know, Christopher Hitchens, we did lose back in 2011. And he was an author, a journalist, and he wrote over 30 books and some essays, or five essays on culture, politics, and literature. The reason why he's so special to me was because when I was a lot younger, I knew I was an atheist. I didn't know how to, I wasn't armed actually with the knowledge, knowing what I felt inside. So, I also have this Hitchens candle right here, if you can see. So anyways, when I finally started watching some of the YouTube videos he had, when I started reading some of the articles that he wrote, I started to feel so at ease because I knew I felt these things that he wrote down. So with that said, one video speaks out to me, and it was when he was in a debate, he actually brought up, a lot of what people think of atheism, which was, well, when you die, that's it. So how is that a way to live? How is that a happy way to be a person and be alive? Well, I thought it was very interesting what he had to say to that. And I'm going to read that quote right here. In theory, the event horizon is the point at which a black hole is pulling everything into itself. So over into the black hole goes light itself. It's so strong, it can pull light back into itself. It's really awe-inspiring. A lot more, say, than a crowd of pigs infested by devils running down a hill into the sea, which is a piece of sorcery and cheap magic of a sort that shouldn't impress anything or person. Be sure the black hole is there, pulling the light into itself, the event horizon just reorganizing nature. So that if you could get into the lip of that event horizon and fall in, you could, in theory, see the past and the present stretching before you. You would see time, except you wouldn't have the time to do it. Of course, if you were a mere primate, as we are, that would be majesty. That would be a magnificence, and that would be awe-inspiring. It's in the world of science and doubt and the world of innovation and discovery, we wouldn't have discovered any of these things if we'd taken the religious story for granted to begin with. God made this. God wants it this way. What's the need for inquiry? We already have the information we need. That's end quote. So for me, that was very cool to hear, and learning about like the Hubble telescope, seeing what's in space, seeing what the nature is, what it has to offer us just in this life, that gives me much more reason to live. So whenever I have a friend or someone I just met, and you know, they do the classic thing of bombard you with the religious stuff, I ask them, I say, well, why don't you just die now? What's the point of living, and what's the point of enjoying what we have with what we have already? So a lot of people ponder on that, and that's, I think, the best thing they can do for themselves, especially as religious people, or people who are not religious, but they just assume the God theory. So yeah, with that said, thank you for letting me talk, and I'm enjoying all your guys' stories, so please keep it coming.
Gracias, Johnny. Muy interesante. La muerte de Christopher Hitchens fue una terrible pérdida para todo el mundo y es uno de mis escritores favoritos también. Muchas gracias.
We are now opening the honoring ceremony to anyone who would like to be spotlighted to talk about a dead loved one. Everyone is welcome to participate. Please use the raise hand option if you would like to be called upon, or just give us a wave, and or place your name in the chat option.
Memo wants to speak.
Ah, wonderful. Oh.
Wonderful.
And also Ruth Light.
I'm so happy to see Ruth Light.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Ruth.
Good. That's great. My hero is my father. Oh. When I was a child, I asked my father one day, do you believe in God? And he said, well, God is all those things we don't know about the universe, and we're working on it. He was a science person. He was an orthopedic surgeon, actually, but he was a lover of science. And it was his approach to life. He certainly was not a believer, but he felt very strongly when, for example, a patient of his would die. And he would go and pray for them, not because he thought there was anybody listening, but because it made him feel better. He was a very special guy. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Ruth. And you do some wonderful articles about science, which I'm sure was greatly influenced by your father. And is Mr. Memo available to speak?
Can you hear me?
Now, yes.
Yes.
Hi, Margaret. I am so happy to see you. And I'm so grateful that you put this together. I guess this amazing thing together. It's really enjoyable. So thank you very much for putting it. I think I have so many heroes that we cannot choose one, right? So our hero is our family. And my kid, my wife, and my family is all here represented. I have relatives all across the globe. We have Catholics, we have Christians, we have a Buddhist over there. We have secular. My grandpa was a secular, what you could call a secular humanist when there was no such thing, because in Mexico it's very uncommon to be atheist. But I think he is the one who introduced me to critical thinking. And even though he never told me what to think, he put in me the seeds to say, oh, I have to question the official story, in this case, religion. And he was very aware of that. And the day that he knew that he was getting closer to that, he actually wrote letters to each one of his sons and daughters to make sure that he left a message when he was gone, right? That was his way of knowing that. He even put it in those letters. He put it, I do not know where I'm going, but I am so grateful for the time that I was here with you. And if I get to see you again, that's cool. And if not, I just want to know you, tell you that, and you know that, that I love you very much. And that the time that we were here, it was happiness for me, right? Something along the lines that was in Spanish, so it might lose translation. But again, my kid and my wife put together this amazing altar, and we thought that we wanted to share it with you. And that's about it. Again, thank you very much, Margaret, and everybody who made this possible.
I think Peter Rosa Wicks wants to speak.
Hello, how are you guys doing? Thank you, first of all, for this entire thing. It was amazing. It was just so heartwarming. Like, my heart is too big for my tiny body. But I just wanted to talk about, because we were talking about like religion and things. I was raised in a private Catholic grade school. I went from kindergarten to ninth grade, private school Catholic, and then Jesuit high school. But when I was in sixth grade, so I was 12, September 19th, 1999, I'm probably getting annoyingly detailed. My best friend died in a jet ski accident. Oh. It was out of nowhere. Sorry, I'm obviously not over it still, really, but I saw him on Friday. He was so excited. And Saturday was like crazy. It was the worst ever. It drove me to, well, one, immediately shun all religion because I asked questions, and why would a God, this amazing thing, why would he murder my best friend who's 12? And no one answered it. I got to sit with the principal and actually talk about real things, which was the greatest thing for a sixth grader ever. But on top of that, it drove me to being a blackout drunk alcoholic 4 to 7 days a week from when I was 12. I'm 34. I quit drinking 2 years and 2 months ago. Thank you. It was like ridiculous. It was whatever, but things suck. And there isn't some magical being around to who made things and started everything and then just kind of says, you know, only pay attention to me, like a 15-year-old spoiled rotten girl. If you talk about another girl in front of her, she will slash your tires, like, or he will flood your planet or murder millions of people for no reason, whatever. I think we all agree the story is a story, and it's really a mean one too. But I wanted to throw out to my best friend Scott Boring. I love him, and also because my life is like that. 20 years almost to the day, September 14th, 2019. One of the two other kids that I got blackout drunk with for the first time, he killed himself. So, yeah, lots of fun stuff. But I was pretty devastated. I just quit drinking. I quit drinking in July or August of 2019, and this happened in September. Thank everybody so much. And
thanks, Peter. Appreciate it. Thank you. We have Michelle Lagos Young. I think wants to speak next. Hi, Michelle. See if you can unmute yourself. No, okay. Let's give it a second.
Hi, yes. How
there
about
you
now?
Go. Yeah.
Hi, perfect. Thank you so much for giving me a moment. I hadn't planned on speaking because I'm actually still at work, but the lovely thing about having this program online is that I have the opportunity to step away and listen and celebrate the lives of those people that changed us. For me today, it's my grandmother, Maria Magdalena Lagos. And she was born in Peru in 1940.
She was just a beautiful person. She actually was the one that convinced her husband to immigrate to the United States, which really opened up the floodgates for our family to come to the United States and to have just a completely different standard of living than what they had in Peru. My family was from the smaller towns to the south of Lima. My mother was, you know, just, she was born in Peru as well. And so it was my grandmother, my mom, her sister-in-law, and her sister-in-law's son, the four of them with my grandfather, who came to the United States together. You know, my grandmother really molded me. I think, as with a lot of people of Latin descent, I was raised by her. My mother had to work multiple jobs to keep food on the table. She went homeless for a little while. My mother, because she was taking care of us, she trying to take care of us. But as for my grandmother, you know, her biggest love was soccer, knitting, and her grandchildren. As far as soccer goes, she actually had to strap her chest down, because when she was in 1950s, she wasn't allowed to play soccer as a woman. And so she would go out there and play soccer. She wanted to get educated, which was another reason she came to the United States. She was pulled from school in early grade school, because that was the culture then in Peru, in rural Peru, is women didn't go to school for very long. Taught herself how to crochet. And as far as her grandchildren, everyone was her grandchildren. Like a stereotypical Latin grandmother, she met you once and she wanted to feed you all of the Peruvian food that you could eat. And she wanted to make sure that you were doing well. So I want to thank you for this opportunity to speak about her. She passed away last year of cancer, but because of the circumstances in the medical field last year with COVID, we unfortunately really weren't able to be there with her in her last month. So that was very difficult. But thank you all very much. And thank you for celebrating the lives of those people that meant so much for us, and holding space so that we could do that. Thank you.
That was a beautiful tribute. Thank you for attending and telling us about that. And you really brought your loved one back to life with your stories. Thank you.
Kristen Stollers, I think, wants to say a few words.
Hello. And I'm going to keep this brief. I just had to have a lip biopsy, so it's a little hard to speak. I would like to just say, honor my late grandfather. He died back in 2017. However, he was one of the prominent people in our family who really led us to free thinking and the tradition of free thought in our family. His ancestors also were quite noted for that in their time, the time that they lived in. And one of the most important things that he taught us was the whole idea of giving back and doing things for, you know, help build homes for organization that was near his hometown and things like that, helping with homeless youth and things like that. In fact, all of his memorial, we did a big donation to that local youth service bureau that was in honor of him. But one of those things is just, it's nice to remember and think about people in that way too, to kind of keep the memory alive by helping others and continuing to be of service that way.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
That was lovely.
Okay. Como hemos dicho antes, el Día Secular de los Muertos
tendríamos unos cuantos premios. Los premios son el mejor día de los muertos o, y la ganadora o ganadores son. Vamos a empezar con el mejor día, el mejor Zoom del Día de los Muertos, el ambiente. Y para este, a ver, lo tengo acá apuntado porque ya hay un ganador y el ganador es Benumea Memo. Es el ganador del mejor ambiente con las fotos de su familia. Y es, ahí está, eso, ahí está. De modo que muchas gracias, Memo, por haber preparado tan bonito el ambiente. Perfecto, exacto.
And the winner for the best face painting is Jane Lorenzen. You had a beautiful face painting picture up. I don't know if that was you from a previous event, but it was beautiful. So we're going to give you the prize for the best face painting.
Quería ver si había otra, pero el mejor adorno del cabello es de Luis Danielson. De modo que ahí está. Me gusta mucho. Muy, muy bonito.
And Louise Danielson joins us from Denmark. So great to see you again, Louise. Thank you for coming.
Now I think we're ready.
All right. All right. Well, congratulations again to all of our winners. You can choose your prizes from us when we connect via email. Thank you all for attending this year's Secular Day of the Dead de los Muertos ceremony.
Espero que hayan disfrutado mucho de la iluminación de las velas y la bienvenida de nuestros copatrocinadores que incluyeron a Hispanic American Freethinkers, the Free Thought Society, the Center for Inquiry, Freedom from Religion Foundation, American Atheist, Secular Student Alliance, the Secular Coalition for America, and Atheist United.
And we thank John Huertas for sharing his journey story with us today. And we also appreciate the wonderful interview that Julia Sweeney conducted with him.
Y también gracias a Fernando Alcántar, Hugh Taff Morales, y Consuelo Cortés de Fleming por sus videos y palabras tan lindas.
Y un millón de gracias a Samantha Maguire y Melissa Myers por su ayuda técnica antes y durante todo este programa.
We also thank our talented entertainers, John Davidson, Margarita Reña, James Nunnally, Christine Magdalenas Jones, and Abraham Steve Mackey, and Gary Stockdale, who you'll hear in just a moment.
Pero ahorita tenemos una canción, El Rancho Grande.
You'll hear the piano playing of Christina Magdalenas Jones during the credit slideshow. And afterwards, Gary Stockdale will sing the free thought anthem, Imagine, in Spanish. Adios, everyone.
Hasta luego.
Gracias.
I have some special words for our Spanish-speaking friends. Un saludo especial a todos nuestros amigos de habla España. Quiero tocarles una canción que aprendí de niño. And what I hope I said was, I'm going to play a song for you that I learned as a boy. I also forgot it over the years, so I've had to relearn it. Here it is. It's called Rancho Grande. Allá en el Rancho Grande, allá donde vivía, había una rancherita que alegre me decía, que alegre me decía. Te voy a hacer tus calzones como que uso el ranchero. Te los comienzo de lana, te los acabo de cuero. Su mamá le dice a Julia, su mamá le dice a Julia, que le ha dicho ese señor. Ay, 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 ay.
Mama no no dio nada, mama no me dio nada, solo de hablo de amor. Ay, ay, ay. El gusto de los vaqueros es tener una muchacha para salir a la plaza y dar vuelo a la hilacha. Allá en el rancho grande, allá donde vivía, había una rancherita que alegre me decía, que alegre me decía, te voy a hacer tus calzones como que uso el ranchero, de los comienzos de lana, de los acabos de cuero. Allá en el rancho grande, allá donde vivía, vi una rancherita que alegre me decía, que alegre me decía, te voy a hacer tus calzones como que uso el ranchero, de los comienzos de lana, de los acabo de cuero.
going to sing a lovely Spanish translation of John Lennon's Imagine that I originally heard by a Latin artist named David Ponce. Imagine has become an anthem for the non-theistic community, and singing it in a language other than English just amplifies its universal meaning. There are physical representations of it in two places that most represented home to John Lennon. The John Lennon Airport in Liverpool has the line, "Above us only sky," painted on the roof. And Yoko Ono's monument to her husband in the Strawberry Fields section of Central Park is a mosaic of the word imagine, where fans gather to mourn him as well as to celebrate his legacy. I was lucky enough to sing on many records for Latin artists in the early 90s, such as Chayanne, Roberto Carlos, Ana Gabriel, Juan Gabriel, and others, and it is always my joy to sing in Spanish. Thanks again for making me a part of this great celebration. Y disfruta de este gran evento.
Que tampoco haya infiernos, solo el cielo y nada más. Imagina la gente viviendo en paz. Que no existan países. Difícil de lograr que no haya más violencias ni religiones ya. Imagina la gente viviendo todo en paz. Un soñador dirás que soy. Espero que te nos unas y el mundo será mejor. Que no hayan posesiones, lo podemos lograr sin codicia ni hambre, solo la hermandad. Sin codicia ni amor.